Okay, so we'll start the first topic. It's you're saying that science shows that the universe had a beginning. So I'll give you a minute to set up the discussion on how you would like to take it. And so basically we want to highlight points of agreement and also disagreement, and we can talk about where we disagree and why.
Right. Yeah, I think when I look at the issue of a beginning, this seems to be scientifically something that has played out over the last 100 or so years since the advent of Einstein's development of the theory of general relativity. That before that, it just didn't seem to be a question. But in general relativity, you've got this dynamic nature to space and time. And there have been just a number of key discoveries throughout the last 100 years that even though scientists have proposed and continue to propose models that don't have a beginning, it seems like the data keeps driving us back to the idea that the universe began to exist. And when I, again, look at what Scripture has to say, that's one of those doctrines that seems to play pretty prominently. You've got this doctrine of creation ex nihilo, that God transcends the physical universe and brings the universe into existence. And so I find this corroboration between what we find scientifically and important biblical doctrines. And I think that's pointing to the idea that God is the author of both of those.
Okay, yeah. I think it was J.P. Moreland who did a presentation on this, and I did a little counter-presentation to it once. But he went into great detail about how we know there was a beginning to the universe. And so I would like to say that, you know, I think we have common ground on that. I believe there is also a beginning. We can say the Big Bang was the beginning of time and space, and maybe there's a multiverse or something out there that gave birth to our universe. So can we go forward from that point? I mean, let's say we have a common, can we say we have a common agreement there that there's a time, a beginning for the universe?
Yeah, I think that does. I mean, we could spend a lot of time talking about some of the things why scientists say there might not be a beginning, but I think it sounds like we have a common ground there.
Well, why would a scientist say there's not a beginning?
Well, the big reason is that in order to answer the question of whether there's a beginning or not, we need a quantum theory of gravity, and we just don't have that theory yet. And so there is this little bit of uncertainty as to whether the universe genuinely has a beginning or not. But you know, I don't think we're going to have the answer to that for another couple of decades. So.
Well, I think I've also heard, too, that, you know, I don't know, so this is your field of work, so you would probably know more about this as far as rumors and stuff, but from what I heard, according to the Big Bang Theory, some people say that could have been the beginning of time and space, but some say they don't know. It may not have been the beginning of time and space. Basically, the correct answer is we don't know.
Yeah, and that's often, or at least the objection or the response I've heard from those who want to argue that quantum gravity will get around a beginning, or at least it says that we just don't know. You look at the Christian apologist who's going to argue for a beginning, they'll look at something like the space-time theorems of general relativity. The problem with those is that, or the weakness in those is that in order for that to establish that there's a beginning, general relativity has to be true, and precisely the moment we expect it to break down is right at the beginning. And so there's a little bit of uncertainty there. But, you know, the response, just to echo what you're saying, is that some people say, well, we don't know whether there's a beginning, so let's not overstate what we know at this point.
Yeah, actually, so, you know, the way I understand it, too, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but, the reason why they say there's probably a Big Bang is because we see everything going away from each other, and it's actually speeding up. All the planets, all the galaxies, all the galaxies are, generally speaking, going away from each other. I mean, sometimes they come together, like the Milky Way is on a collision course with Andromeda Galaxy, I guess. But most of the universes are all, I mean, most of the galaxies are all spreading out. And so they say, well, if you play that tape backwards, it all comes to a certain point. And that's according to Einstein's theory of relativity or general relativity. But when you start shrinking it down and you get to the quantum mechanics, that's where Einstein general theory of relativity no longer comes into play. And now we have quantum mechanics and there's all these unknowns in quantum mechanics. Is that right?
Well, it's not so much just that there's unknown, it's that you need to have a quantum theory of gravity, and we don't know what that looks like. but at least a couple of the ideas that we have for that might be a quantum theory of gravity indicate that there might be a minimum size. And so instead of collapsing down to a point or a singularity, it might be that you end up kind of the universe goes through this smallest phase, maybe from a prior contracting phase. And so, you know, there's a whole lot of it's not a settled issue. That's my only point. But
Right. But
I do think that there's the idea that the universe began to exist is a credible idea, although it's not settled by any stretch.
Well, you know, another interesting thing there that I think people don't realize is, you know, tell me if I'm wrong or not, but scientists don't even really know what gravity is. Like maybe there's a graviton or something. I think that's what you're talking about a quantum level of gravity that we don't really even understand what gravity is, right?
I think there's some real truth to that. I mean, you know, at least with you when you've got Einstein's theory of relativity, there is at least a physical mechanism for how gravity works because you're warping the fabric of space and time. But again, that's fundamentally a classical theory. It's not a quantum theory. And so it's unknown what that true quantum nature of gravity is. And because gravity is such a weak force, it's really difficult to do the experiments on the small scales that allow us to figure out what sort of parameters constrain it.
Yeah, so I mean, basically we know it's there. We can see the time-space warping and all that. We can see the effects of it, but exactly how does it do it? Is there a graviton or whatever? We have no idea in science how that actually happens.
Right, but even in the context of all that, I think it's important to note that general relativity is a spectacularly successful theory in describing the dynamics of the universe, not the least of which is this prediction of gravitational waves that were detected a few months ago. So it really is a phenomenally successful theory, but there is just this question of how does it get modified when you get down onto the smallest scales like would happen at the beginning of the universe.
Okay, so I believe that, you know, the universe could have had a beginning. Maybe it was birthed by something else like a multiverse, and, you know, energy could be eternal. So what's wrong with that, or what? Why do you think that there must be a God to answer it? And doesn't, if you say God started it, isn't that just a, like what they say, a mystery wrapped in an enigma, since we don't know what God is? It just kind of, when you say God did it, it's like, that's like saying nothing, because it doesn't explain anything. It's just saying magic, kind of.
Well, no, there's a place where I agree with what you said and a place where I disagree. And so I'll hit the place where I disagree is that one, the idea of a multiverse, at least when you're talking inflationary type multiverses, those still seem to have a beginning. So the Big Bang, you know, the beginning of our universe is no longer the beginning, but even the multiverse seems to have a beginning. And so there's a little bit of even positing the multiverse doesn't get you to something eternal. But I agree very much with your point that what you're saying is that because our universe exists, or even because there's a Big Bang, that there needs to be something eternal. And so in my assessment, the real question is, what is the nature of that eternal being or substance, if you will? You know, you could say that it's energy, but what I would argue is that in order for whatever that eternal self-existent stuff is, it has to be eternal. It has to be self-existent. It's got to have the capacity to bring universes into existence. And if consciousness is something that, in order to explain consciousness, I think you can make an argument that it also has to be conscious. And so, you know, it's
why does it have to be conscious?
Well, you do run into this problem or this, if you're going to say energy is eternal and that's what explains our universe, that thing has to explain everything about our universe. And so there's the question of if consciousness is just purely a, or that raises the question of, is consciousness just purely a physical phenomena, or is it something beyond just physical? And
that's a different question. What is consciousness? I mean, the question though is, why does the beginner of everything have to have a consciousness?
Well, because if we have consciousness, whatever caused us had to be able, or it has to be an adequate cause of that.
Yeah, but why does it have to be conscious?
Because we're conscious. What if we're conscious and whatever it is that produced us isn't, then in some sense why, we're but, greater yeah, but, than what was...
But still, I mean, if we had feathers, you wouldn't have to say the Creator had feathers, because we have feathers. So we have consciousness, but why does our why do we have to come from consciousness?
Well, but there is a fundamental distinction there, in that feathers are a way to rearrange the matter. And so if we're just talking about rearranging matter, that works. But if consciousness isn't just rearranging the matter, then you end up with this odd thing that we can think about the universe, but the universe can't think about us. And so we're greater than the universe in that capacity, or greater than the energy that caused the universe.
I don't know if it's greater. I mean, I mean, that's, why is it, I don't think it's greater. I mean, why couldn't consciousness just be a property or attribute of things that evolved? That, you know, if there's no God, all these different things happen. Like, you know, there's all kinds of different levels of consciousness from different animals. The more complex brain, the more consciousness. So, you know, if humans never evolved and there were just ants, this is a difficult question to give you, because I know you don't accept evolution. So maybe we're showing a huge difference in understanding there.
Well, I guess to me the central question, and, you know, independent of what goes on in the rest of the animal kingdom, I do agree that there's different levels of awareness of the environment by different animals, and so ants don't have nearly the perception of the world that, say, a dog would. But to me, the key distinction is that as humans, we can think about how the world operates, but the world doesn't think about how we operate, that there's a fundamental distinction there, that all things considered equal, that a God better motivates why we're conscious than a non-conscious, self-existent reality.
Okay, I don't see how it follows. But we can move on to the next topic. Do you want to say anything in closing? Like, give you last word there, if you want to say anything on closing on that.
Yeah, I guess I would, you know, what I will find, or I'll reiterate this with each of these. I don't think any of these are slam dunk. Oh, this is the only way to look at this, is that God exists. But I do think, given all of this, that the best explanation for all of these is kind of a cumulative case. The best explanation is God. And so that doesn't preclude that there may be some other mechanism for explaining this from a different worldview.
Okay, and I guess one thing I like to say, sometimes, you know, Christians do say we don't have a knockdown argument, but we do have a cumulative case. We have this argument, this argument, this argument, this argument. And in my opinion, all the arguments are invalid. They're like logical fallacies of one sort or another. So just because you have a whole bunch doesn't mean your whole argument's any better. I mean, I think it's a cumulative case of logical fallacies, personally. So,
can you tell me where's the logical fallacy, and if there's a beginner, or if there's a beginning, then that points to a beginner or a self-existent reality that causes the universe?
Well,
the
biggest thing on the top of my mind is that you say, for example, consciousness needs to be explained, and you explain that by a consciousness that just always existed, and basically this is a God. It's a God without a brain too, because biologically we have brains and our minds come from our brains, and yet God does not have a brain because he's not physical, but he's got a mind. So he's got a brainless mind because there's no brain, but everything we know about minds only come from brains, and so that's a huge gap. I mean, why can God do that? Well, there's special pleading. Oh, only God can do this. You know, it's only a case for God.
Well, I mean, again, I guess I would look at that from a worldview of, you say, okay, if God exists, then what are the attributes of God as he's revealed them to us? And part of how he's revealed is that he has the capacity to bring physical existence, or the physical realm into existence. And so I don't see why that's a contradiction, given the character of God, that he has the capacity and the power to do to create beyond space and time, matter and energy. Why is it a contradiction to say that he can create a certain type of consciousness that doesn't exceed his?
Okay, so ready to go on to the next one?
Sure.